Well, now think about something that's interesting from a perpetual motion standpoint. Can we extract power from noise? We've said that the average voltage or the average flow of current in a noisy circuit is zero, but the RMS voltage or the RMS current might not be zero. Look at our graph. We have zero average voltage, but we don't have zero RMS voltage. I know that quite simply because if I take any random circuit, turn the oscilloscope on and measure that circuit without the power supply attached, I'll get a graph like what we see right here. With the RMS voltage not being zero, can I somehow extract power from that noisy circuit and use it to do useful work? Well, the answer is no, but I need to explain why. We're essentially modeling our noise as a hot resistor. That is, a resistor that's producing power and also consuming it sitting in a hot room. What happens if I take this circuit, which has a finite non-zero RMS voltage, and I attach it to another resistor? Will I get power flow around the circuit? Let's draw out what I want to do. I have a power source, I have some resistors, let me call this R load, and I already know I have a non-zero RMS voltage across my load resistor. So why doesn't it work? Why can't I extract useful power from my noisy circuit? Well, the answer, first of all, is that it's very likely that the load resistor is going to be sitting in the same environment as our hot resistor. In other words, my mathematical model here for our load resistor is not perfect. Let's fix it. If the load resistor is sitting in the same thermal environment as our hot resistor, then the load resistor is also hot. That is, it also is noisy. So if you have a load resistor in thermal equilibrium with your hot resistor, then you're not actually going to have any power flow around the circuit. These sources are going to cancel out. On the other hand, if you had a cold load resistor, that is, if you had a hot resistor sitting in a very hot room connected up to a cold resistor in a very cold room, these two resistors would try to reach thermodynamic equilibrium by exchanging power along the wire, and you would be able to extract energy from the system in that way. In order for it to work, you would have to isolate the two sides of the circuit. We would have to have a hot room and a cold room. The presence of this circuit would help the two sides of the room reach thermodynamic equilibrium. In other words, the hot room is going to get a little bit colder and the cold room is going to get a little bit hotter because of the arrangement that I've drawn right here. Power flowing away from a hot resistor in a circuit is analogous to power flow away from a hot object sitting in a cold room. If you sit a hot object in a room, then it's going to start radiating away all of its energy into the environment. That's entirely analogous to the situation of putting a hot resistor in a circuit connected to a lot of cold components. It's going to be noisy, but it's going to get less noisy over time, in terms of the thermal noise at least. Going back to the question that I asked, can we extract power from noise? Well, in certain situations, but only if it's compatible with the laws of thermodynamics. Generally speaking, in electronics, circuits are confined within a small area and it's impossible to extract anything useful from the noise. We want to avoid the noise. Let's now talk about how noise is typically defined. Or if you look at the data sheet for some electrical component and you see something related to noise, how is it going to be expressed? I'd like to look first at the noise spectral density, and we'll first consider white noise because it's a little bit easy to consider. In other words, I'm going to consider noise that has an equal amount of power at a high frequency as it does at a low frequency. I'm showing a plot here of power density versus frequency. I'm calling it power density because it's not exactly power in the vertical axis. Let's call the power density S. If I wanted to know the total power represented by this plot, I would have to integrate the power density over all of the frequencies. I mentioned before that white noise does eventually have to tail off, otherwise you would calculate infinite power contained in your noise. Oftentimes in circuits, there's a limited bandwidth over which the circuit needs to operate. In other words, a circuit might not need to work at really low frequencies, and a circuit might not need to work at really high frequencies. The usable bandwidth is going to be important right here. Let's call the bandwidth delta F, that range of frequencies over which we're interested. We can now consider how much power is present due to the noise over this bandwidth that we're interested in. If we call this point F1, and this point F2, then we just need to integrate between F1 and F2. This equation is true for all types of noise, and now you're going to see why I'm looking at white noise for this particular example. It's easy to make the integral, isn't it? Our power density is just flat. There's another expression for average power. That's V squared over R. Let's now take a moment and remind ourselves what the unit needs to be for all of these quantities. Power is measured in watts, RMS voltage in volts, resistance in ohms. Power density needs to be watt per hertz so that the units work out when I plug in my bandwidth, which is also given in hertz. I now want to rearrange the terms just a little bit. Let's multiply everything times R and divide it by our bandwidth. When I do that here with the second term, I'm going to reposition the square. The reason I've rearranged the terms this way is because the expression sitting inside of the parentheses here is called the noise amplitude spectral density. The units here are a little bit weird, volts per square root hertz, but this is a unit that you'll see a lot when you're talking about noise. What it boils down to is that noise has a power density. And because power is related to the square of the voltage, we end up with this funny square root of the bandwidth here in the denominator. Let's call it V bar. We'll call it the noise voltage density or the noise amplitude density. Let me now show you how we can use this figure to calculate something useful. This is the expression that we've just defined. Let's rewrite it in terms of the RMS voltage. Quite often when we consider an electrical circuit, what we're really interested in knowing is whether the noise is going to be a problem or not. In other words, does the voltage level of our signal compare favorably with the voltage level of our noise? Knowing the noise amplitude spectral density can help us answer that question. Let me give you an example. Let's say that you've looked at the data sheet for some electrical component, and the data sheet has told you that this is the noise level, 10 nanovolt per square root hertz. Let's say that we're designing a circuit that's going to work over the audio range. How much noise can we expect at the output? Well, we can consider that the audio bandwidth is going to be about 20 kilohertz. That's basically our delta F. It's now a very simple calculation to calculate the RMS voltage that we can expect due to the noise. First, let's plug in the noise, and then we'll plug in the bandwidth to our formula. The unit cancels just nicely, and we wind up with 1.41 microvolts. If your signal is a lot larger than 1.41 microvolts, then no problem. But if you're working with very, very small signals, then you have to, of course, give this some attention. In the next videos, I'm going to look at both thermal noise and shot noise in more detail. But before we wrap up this video, I want to leave you with one final thought that might be relevant when you go to design circuits. Consider our formula here for the RMS voltage, and notice that bandwidth is in the numerator. What it means is that if you're designing an electrical circuit, you should not design it to operate over excessively large bandwidths. If you have an electronic circuit with a very large bandwidth, you can expect more noise to come out of that circuit. Therefore, it's good practice to limit your bandwidth to the bandwidth over which you really need your circuit to operate.